like grants, what you're part of the region. So thank you very much that you accept our invitation, and we are looking forward for your presentation. It's very important for our students because we focus this year to topic of Okona, Okona Street, and we try to develop it or study it from all aspects of urban and from all urban and social economic aspects. So this is very important for our students to focus also to art, urban design, culture, industry, and also problem of design. Thank you very much.
I just would like to add that we started the cooperation with Faculty of Architecture, Technical University Bratislava in the beginning of this year, and we already had the national lectures and workshops. It was in February when I started architectural production, and then in May we had the Ambar Rahman from Budapest with Pepe Tournemont concept, and now we welcome Mihai Kinane from Vienna, who has a background in architecture, art and history, and he has worked for a long time on the topic of the production and fear of crime, and his findings resulted in exhibition, theater performances, guided tours and a book published in 2003 in Vienna for real crime. And I would like also to add that Mihai Kinane, together with Mihai Kirchmeier from Vienna, they are also working on another topic of urban space, transnational mobility, and migration. And they also co-founded a research platform called Tracing Spaces. And they co-curated the exhibition Road Register, which was on view in this autumn at the Academy of Fine Arts in Vienna. And another topic of Mihai is holiday tea-tile architecture. He studied so far in Bulgaria and Croatia. This resulted also in exhibitions, guiding things, and also co-editing a book. So before letting you start the lecture, I would like to ask Katarina Smakalova, who is our partner in the series of lectures, or also to tell about her perspective on this cooperation.
Okay, so maybe we'll just add on what Ms. Vitkova was saying. So this cooperation between Jazz and Faculty of Architecture is an attempt to somehow merge again the technical university or technical approach to architecture to the artistic one, and try to find the ways how to also incorporate these issues into the teaching process. Therefore, we are always trying with each of these lectures to somehow fit it to the urban design studio or other design studios that are the main subject on our faculty. Usually it's the same format as for today, so it's the presentation of the lecture that is then followed by the workshop. So the main aim is to not only just to get a theoretical perspective, but also then to really learn by the experiment and learn by doing.
Mm-hmm.
So
thank you for the invitation. That is enough. As mentioned in the introduction, I was originally studying architecture, and the very golden years of Austrian economy for architects, especially in Graz. Then I was doing a postgraduate study in history, but I was always in between both parts, both as a practicing artist, as a practicing architect, and as a curator producing our own projects in Forum Stadtwerk in Graz. And also now we have a project room in the former railway station that is used as a logistic hub in the north of the city of Vienna, where most of the others speak, of course, Slavic languages, most of them Yugoslavic languages. And we use this space as a sort of condenser for containing and collecting and exhibiting ideas about mobility and migration in the wider area from Vienna, which reaches, of course, to all the ends of the mobility streams. And this project is, let's say, I just called it an all-time classic, because it started quite early in my life, when my artist wife had a grant for Los Angeles, and I was trying to follow her. And in Los Angeles, at a period of time, there were a lot of discussions about insecurity in public space. And Mike Davis had published his book, City of Quarks, that was very inspiring for us, let's say, a sort of American vulgar Marxist interpretation, critique of privatization and militarization of space. And when I returned back home, I started to do investigations on the same issue in Vienna, which is, of course, very ridiculous, because Vienna is so super safe, it's so super boring. Almost everything seems to be owned by the city or by some insurance companies that are, again, partly owned by the city. And I therefore developed a sort of discursive format, which I just wanted to show briefly, which is not part of this lecture. So I developed this project I'm speaking about today. Today I'm doing a lecture, I'm speaking about the project, by doing bus trips and walks around Vienna with experts of all kinds, including a feminist activist in making the streets safer for enabling women in that period of time to approach different parts of the city, like parklands, which were considered to be dangerous places because being occupied by some, in English you call it bullying young men. And on the other hand side, I was doing these tours together with the chief detective of the Vienna Criminal Police, which was the most attractive thing. So I was doing these tours with this person, but inviting other people to the bus for going around. And it culminated into a one-day sort of mini festival where we did a bus tour that lasted 4 hours because it included the international airport of Vienna. And afterwards we went to the Academy of Fine Arts where we made a sort of conference, an academic conference in a non-academic setting. What you see here was the setting that I had built for the conference. It is my childhood memory to a very famous German TV series in English called The Ten Most Wanted. It is a series where the public TV station is bringing up short clips about crimes that happened in the country, asking policemen to explain the evidences, and then asking the people all over Germany, Switzerland, and Austria to call and give hints to trace down the criminals. This public TV program was totally no-go for us as children because our parents said this is the worst evil form of denunciation, you know, of deviant figures. But we had a grandmother who was totally obsessed with the TV programs and we could watch it all the time with a grandmother. And in this program there was a blue box background and there was a window, not literally, I built it literally, a window to Vienna, a window to Switzerland, where the minor crimes from Vienna and Switzerland, which never could compete with the German crimes, were presented. And so in this sort of stage set, I was sitting here as the moderator. First show was done with Georg Schölemann as the moderator, because at that time he was a guy, now a famous curator, who was rather bold then, had very big glasses and looked like a 70s TV presenter. So I thought he's the ideal person for doing the job. And in this case, I was sitting there, and all the scholars, police detectives, feminist activists had to climb up this weird stage to sit in the window and then present their case outside of this window. And one of the guys that I invited was a historian from this dealing with the suburban myth of the turn of the century and 10s and 20s of the last century. So let's say the heroic period of time and also when each city had its gangster gang that had some sort of Robin Hood appeal. And interestingly, after this very weird, strange show, he invited me to make a doctorate in history about the issue. I said, oh God, what a weird idea. I have no idea how to make a doctorate in history. He said, it's easy, you know, if I have so much knowledge accumulated about it, I just need to write it down. And then he told me that if we go with Michel Foucault for historiography instead of linear history, it's very easy. You just write some chapters and a good argumentation how it fits together. And this is what I will do now. So, but this is not the super academic lecture, because the super academic lecture is something that is so complicated that I have to read it, and I don't like to read. So if you're interested, you know, you can read the real texts in English. And luckily, Jan Christek, a friend from Brno, had made a Czech translation of one of the, let's say, shortest texts that I've ever written on this issue for this magazine, which I suppose is a gift from the editor. So Jan is only a minor assistant editor, but we interpret that this is a gift from Era 21 magazine to all of you. And it's interesting because it's generally about control. Well, that's it. And, this lecture I will start now is a lecture that was developed in parallel to all the events I had made in quite a long period of time, because it altered all the time when somebody new came up or shared a tour with me, or when we made some presentations like before. I did the presentation several times with different guests later. And of course, I incorporated all the knowledge into mine as well. That's why the book took quite a long time. And this is a book, in case you're interested. It's sadly in German only, but at that period of time, I was totally stressed writing a book in German, but also, you know, making it, thinking in German. In the meantime, I learned to think in English. So I put the current project we develop Think and Write in English, but if switching between the two issues is extremely complicated, because there's a specific German intellectual way of thinking that undermines the British English thinking and the other way around. So it doesn't really work together. So this is the photograph I also used for the cover of my book. It's from Julius Shulman, the most important American photographer of late modernist architecture in the States. And what you can see here, this vault of a bank, is also done by one of the most famous architecture offices ever in the world, SOM Architects, Skidmore, Owings & Merrill, which is today the biggest office in the world with 1,000 employees and several offices all over. More or less, let's say the civic arm of United States expansion in the world. So building embassies, cultural centers, etc. And interestingly, this vault is not so much featured by the office themselves, although I think it's a really cool thing to design. So not very, of course, it's difficult to communicate with friends. I made a vault for, you know, millionaires, treasury to be disposed and saved. I will start with the mainstream Hollywood movie. Fortress, most of you might be much too young for that movie. It's directed by Stuart Gordon from 1993, featuring Christopher Lambert as the beautiful male hero. And the plot plays in 2017, so next year, in the USA. And the story is that a couple got pregnant for a second time in their relationship, but the private company, Mantell Corporation, that owns the United States and rules the United States, then doesn't allow to have more than one baby. And although the first baby died, there's no chance for a second one. So they have to escape to a neighbor country, supposedly something like Canada, but it's not explicitly explained, to get the baby born outside. Otherwise, the baby has to be killed by the program of the private government's rules. So, unluckily, both get caught at the border and they got imprisoned. She gets imprisoned to a women in prison, which we'll never ever see during the film, and he gets imprisoned to a man's prison. And this is the fancy car that brings the male prisoners into the desert. And in the desert, there's an underground building complex. This is the elevator getting down 25 floors into the earth, with ventilation to top and the director's office to the very top as well. And from the central elevator tower, there are bridges connecting to galleries. And all the galleries going around this central space, all are lit from the back. So that from the central gallery, you could see into all the cells, which are all continuously open to the inside, but only open at first sight because they have laser that would burn and kill the people if they would cross. And interestingly, of course, this is the perfect illustration of Bentham's panopticon that was designed already in 1787 as the ideal prison for the period to come then. So the screenwriters took over a sort of architecture classic of controlled architecture as a model for building this, let's say, maquette world of a prison in a so-called science fiction movie. Interestingly, all the cells are more or less occupied by an interesting mix of ethnic groups. So we have Christopher Lambert, the beautiful white guy with a bit of Latin love appeal, the Jewish intellectual, the Mexican, the black masculine, hyper-masculine guy, and all these people then somehow fraternize against the evil power that is partly personalized in this prison as well, because otherwise Hollywood movies do not really work. And in addition to the, let's say, panoptic architecture, the perfect surveillance by architecture itself, there's of course also video surveillance. So in the galleries there are these weird video surveillance cameras driving around and are screening all the people and the people's movements, and they're of course listening to the people, but even further, they're controlling them entirely, even their thoughts. This is, let's say, the utopian aspect of the movie. Because when people enter the prison, they're first welcomed by the director himself. So the director tells them, you know, hey, I'm the one, you know, who is in charge, and I will educate you the way we need to get you. And in one situation, at the beginning of the movie, people have to put their head in some loophole and get this sort of, let's say, phallocratic device into the mouth, and then, which is totally absurd, then some sensor is shot into their belly, which is a GPS navigation system and a mind detector that can check the thinking of the people. So this is the view the director has in the surveillance room, in the war room. You can see this person is filmed by the camera, but at the top you can also see green, yellow, and red lights, which means green thoughts are thoughts that are allowed, yellow are conspicuous, and red is no way. So if you go to the border of green, red, yellow, you get electroshocks by the built-in sensor, and if you would go to the red one, then you would be just exploded by the sensor, because the sensor then is a, you know, little bomb in your belly. Of course, there's a happy end. Christopher Lambert somehow becomes a radical opportunist, become to be the slave worker for the director on the top floor, and together with his buddies, they manage to escape. All the buddies of all the other ethnic groups got shot, and only the white middle-class good guy survives and finds, of course, his girlfriend and the baby alive in the unknown country, which is supposedly Canada. And during this ceremony here, when they got implanted with this sensor, they look to some screen, and the screen tells them blinking crime does not pay. And this is what I want to talk about with reference to some famous theoretician, that crime pays very well indeed, argues Karl Marx, hundreds of years, 180, 90 years ago. And the interesting thing is that Karl Marx, who is of course a communist Marxist theoretician, was quoting in this argumentation a bourgeois liberal economist and poet, Bernard de Montville. So Bernard de Montville is an interesting job description. Bernard de Montville was aristocrat, with a lot of leisure time, and he spent the leisure time writing poets and fictitious novels about economic issues, which made him a philosopher of economy at the period of time. And Bernard de Mandeville had written in this book, The Fable of the Bees, that the criminal is much more productive than many more people, and much more productive than you would expect. Because the criminal is not only producing the crime, but is also producing all the prevention measurements against the crime, and there are many. He's also producing the police, the jail, the courthouse, the lawyers, and the professor who's teaching law. He's producing all the moral discourses in society, because if he behaves deviant, the others feel normal. So the society desperately needs people that behave deviant, because otherwise they cannot feel to be the good guys. And he goes then directly into economy with a very bold example, that there is a profession called locksmiths and another profession called burglars. The burglars desperately try to break up locks, which in reaction stimulates the locksmith to make better locks. So there is a permanent competition of improvement that serves capitalist society, but of course, Benoni Montvin did not use the term capitalist society. And interestingly, I found that notion about Karl Marx in some online forum, where some commentator said that Karl Marx wrote with a sense of irony. This must have been a very, let's say, radical Marxist, that he believes that Marx had any notion of irony. Let's say the deconstruction of Marx as a personal character is not that friendly with him anymore. And we also don't know if Marx really had written this notion, or it was Friedrich Engels like most of the time. Anyway, but Marx takes over this notion, and of course, as a brilliant thinker, he adds some great arguments that I cannot really repeat in easily, but interesting. One of the interesting things is, you can find, is that he speaks about a sort of a permanent unbalancing of society in the intention to criticize capitalism, because otherwise people would fall asleep and don't develop any ideas for progress anymore. And interestingly, our Austrian economist professor Schumpeter, who is the godfather of liberal economy, who came after Marx, had praised Marx for his brilliant thinking. He said that Marx was, as a liberal, of course, from the opposite political field, he said Marx was very often very wrong, but that does not mean that he didn't think brilliantly, because thinking is a sort of discipline, and writing theory is a discipline that doesn't necessarily need to be related with reality. So if he doesn't claim to match reality, it doesn't matter. But Marx very often wanted to describe the world as it is, and he also said that very often Marx described the world really like it was, but he was not scientific. So there was a sort of two parts of text that he wrote. Some were brilliant thinking, but wrong in the words of Schumpeter, and others were just speculative and turned out to be true in the long term. And one of the aspects of this productivity, aside of the moral aspect, the punitive aspect, the preventive aspect in detail, and the cultural industry of crime, where I will come back to later, is the productivity for architecture and design. Marx doesn't write anything about architecture. He just quotes Mandeville with this example of the box. But it's very easy, you know, that we all know that all the first buildings were built as a shelter against something, the weather, the wild animals, or the neighbors that want to steal, you know, the fruits of the harvest. And all the first cities were consciously placed as strategically important places that are easily defendable by topographic situations and by fortification strategies. So there is a clear evidence since ever that there is some true aspect in that if you expand it to architecture. And in the book, I just argued if I just collect as much evidence as possible, you know, I have to put it works as a scientific project. Interestingly, it worked very well with all the young people in the field of architecture theory, but it didn't work at all with all the other professors. So I was really deemed as being the evil of architectural theory that takes just some weird arguments. But I will show you now that it works quite nicely. So there are different ways how to classify and organize evidence that I've collected. One would be, where does the threat come from outside or from inside? Normally, we always discuss that the burglar, the thief, the robber, the foreign troops, illegal migrants come from outside to us, to the inside. And we love to have this kept outside, because then, again, the diabolization of the other makes us the good guys that need protection, and that stabilizes us in our thinking, however wrong or right it might be. The other one is from the inside. That's something people do not like very much. My friend from the Vienna State Police Department said, in the case of murder, in 99%, the murderer is a family member. So you just have to look beneath the bed, and you would find, the chances are very high to find the enemy in the closest family. The same is with economic crimes. You know, when a company gets, it's not that it's always some Russian hackers that penetrate the system. In most of the cases, it's some frustrated member of the company that destroys the computer system for the revenge of some, you know, private experience he had with his bosses. And another option would be organizing the knowledge of what kind of intruder would be there. These notions of animal associations were brought up by Jean Baudrillard, the famous French philosopher, after the attack of September 11. So around September 11 and after September 11, the famous attack on the World Trade Center in New York, many people wanted to put themselves on stage to benefit from this, let's say, utmost crime. Many of my friends were totally confused because they wanted to be in faith. They are somehow intuitively anti-American, but on the other hand side, they want to get the grant for the United States to study there. So for them, it was very difficult how to say something about this event, because you're invited by all the magazines to write something about this issue. And Baudrillard said, oh, it's an interesting event to discuss the transformation of intruders from the wolf who was walking on earth, so you just needed to build a wall against the wolf, the rat that was going in the underground system, so the rat was much more flexible than the wolf, so it was more difficult to defend the rat. The beetle is even more difficult because it can fly over and just become a sort of take the wolf or the rat for getting into the area. And the virus is an extreme thing, and as we all know, the sleepers of international terrorism then were called in the discourse as viruses that we produced ourselves. So the Americans produced their enemies by destabilizing some parts of the world, and then got back what they produced as enemies in their own country. And then we could also discuss the types of preventive strategies, and there are two. Let's say this is now a sort of superstitious explanation. How can I defend myself or an urban environment of the home? One is by radical fortification. So let's get for the best concrete, for the smallest windows, for military armies to protect us, and we will be totally safe inside if not our wife or husband or brother kills us, or somebody else who is close with us. And the opposite strategy, which is preferred by most of the people in the planning discipline, also by feminists, friends of mine, and is called democratic, is social control. That means, put to an extreme, if everything built on Earth is out of glass, lit continuously in bright light, having no bushes, no obstacles, so that everybody of us can see each other all the time, nobody would dare to commit crime because he or she would be seen immediately, detected immediately. And this, of course, can be also enhanced, or there are mixed concepts of both the video surveillance that substitutes the glass walls, which are not possible to be produced. But the interesting thing is that this second part was really becoming implemented, let's say the combination of both, was becoming implemented in building regulations for office buildings after bomb attacks, but also in Vienna, for example, after a series of crimes where young women and girls had been the victims, that all the parks in Vienna had got rid of the bushes by law. Of course, the people taking care of the bushes from the city administration didn't follow the instructions, but there was one park built in the city of Vienna where there were no trees lower than 2 meters, no arms of trees lower than 2 meters, no bushes higher than this, and all the lamps were put down on half size so that this park was really looking like a soccer field. It was so super light at night that of course it had no romantic appeal at all anymore, and basically nobody went there anymore. So neither the dangerous people nor those people who were considered to be, who have fear of the others. And interestingly, the two friends of mine who were involved in this project then, nowadays would not want to be called feminist planners anymore, because being feminist planners concentrating on security issue was ruining their career partly. So because they wanted to make big projects and not only parks where they just cut off trees and bushes and put in light, you know, this is not a career for an architect you were dreaming of. Another one would be the categorization of the size of endangered object spaces and protective strategies. And here I used a very silly categorization which I lent it from Rem Koolhaas. Rem Koolhaas had produced this very fat book called Small, Medium, Large, X-Large, where he was more or less cynically proposing his design ideas like t-shirts in different sizes, and partly developed with one of the most famous graphic designers, Bruce Mao. And so I thought we could use this small, medium, large, X-large categorization as well for my examples which are coming now. The lock, I've spoken about it already. Pre-Christian time, old, from yesterday. And this is a very interesting example because this drawing is from a very thick, very valuable book published in 1588 about miraculous machines by Capitano Ramelli, a military engineer who developed weapons to break into buildings, defensive and offensive weapons. And interestingly, as you can see here, he made an example how you can open the door of a very, very big castle. And you can see that the criminal intelligence of Ramelli, or his military intelligence from Ramelli, was then available as a big booklet by all those people who could read the book, but you didn't need to read the book because they had these comic-like illustrations anyway. So it was a very good, let's say, advice how to break up doors that seemed to be really safe. Then, of course, the 1920s saw a very big offensive advertisement of security techniques in building exhibitions. This is from Germany in the 30s. So if you have this automatic Rollo and the burglars want to take the jewelry, it goes down like guillotine and almost cuts off his hand. So we'll think about it a second time. And from contemporary times, it's an ad from a German-based surveillance camera company. It's not only building surveillance camera. Siedel is actually producing these call devices. You ring at the door and then you speak to the people, which you can also have with video. In addition, to feel more safe, you can see who is ringing at the door. And then they made this photograph because they needed some sort of American-looking scary city, which is Frankfurt, the only one that looks really American and scary, so a Hollywood like space of fear. And the text says, not all streets can be safe. And on the opposite side, but your house, your home, will be with our video surveillance system. And it's interesting, when I was doing a lecture in Germany, I got sponsored by exactly this company. So they paid my lecture. And interestingly, afterwards, I was invited to the board of the company to give them advice how to make a smarter PR work for that goods so that nobody like me will ever criticize them, you know, the way. So you can see that Marx's idea of the productivity of crime even gets me, you know, pulled back into a sort of very good optimizer of capitalism. And even for Viennese, very painful, the Karl Marx of the social housing blocks of the 20s and 30s have been, of course, brilliant examples of social housing. They have been brilliant examples of educational hygienic progress, but they also have been brilliant examples of how to control the population. Because despite of this one, you are here, all the staircases are addressed to the inner side of the yard, so nobody can reach the street immediately. So they all have to gather in the inside yard, passing by these buildings to the outside, and this is the kindergarten and the laundry house. So the cathedrals of hygienic progress and education are, let's say, the major symbolic monuments in the inside of the yard. And you cannot leave your inside yard without passing by some of the professionals of the city of Vienna, administration and education, which look if you're dressed accurately, if you behave accurately, and if you're getting your educational bits accurately. That led to some interesting misbehavior in the yards, because misbehaving in the yards was forbidden, so that they went outside to the street again, to the authentic place of childhood and adolescent experience. And of course we know that we have a boom of gated communities, which are very often advertised as sort of paradise, where everything evil is kept outside, and only those who have a chip card can enter. And interesting, in the meantime, we have a lot of movies about these gated communities. They also became extremely popular in post-socialist countries, but also, for example, in Turkey. And strangely, the people believe what is advertised, that they are living in a social enclave with all people of same interest. But while they're leaving at daytime, all the servants come in, and all the servants are from that ethnic groups or social groups. They want to be fenced off normally. So interestingly, it's a total absurd sort of suppression of those who do not want to have, because you need them to clean up your house or take care of your children. And we have, of course, great movies and great novels, especially D.C. Boyle's Tortilla Curtain, one of the most, let's say, the meanest ever book ever written about educated middle classes that fence themselves into such a compound, not because of racism, but because of the children, that they grew up in a safe neighborhood. And bring the children, of course, every day to some special school where there are no Mexicans, not because they are against Mexican dialect, but because this is the best school with the best rating and there's no other option. Of course, I can highly recommend to reread this book, Tortilla Curtain, by D.C. Boyle, because at the end everything burns down. And the Mexican guy who is the gardener burns down the house by accident. It's a really horrible book, because there's no chance for any happy end. And you see, next chapter gets worse and worse and worse. And oh God, 200 pages and it's already that bad. Sometimes gates do not have, you know, just need to be symbolically made. And interestingly, what I didn't know before, I thought this is some sort of leftist propaganda about American social housing. And last 2 years before, I was in New York visiting several social housing blocks in New York. And the interesting thing is that in the US, they have an interesting concept about social housing, that social housing blocks should look awful from outside. They should have no amenities, because the policy is people on their way to social success should be supported only in a very short period of time in these apartments, which are too small, have no balconies, have small windows, look horrible, not inviting at all, because then they would be inspired to work hard to make their life and success and get to the suburbs or some big palace, which has a balcony. And interestingly, I thought this is from a movie, but if this was a praised social housing system in Chicago. And interestingly, some very famous architecture office made a social housing project 10 years before, looking exactly the same, like a prison. And sometimes in some other areas of the world, you have even sort of military forces protecting the area for separating people that are suspected not to be able to live with each other. And I came up with another interesting movie that is also quite old. It's the movie The Siege from 1989, which shows the September 11 attack as a sort of future imagination. In the establishing shots of this movie, you see some sheikh in the desert of an unknown country that is taken hostage by secret American forces. And that is cut, and it's the title, and later on a series of terrorist attacks starts in New York. And Bruce Willis is hired to shut them all down. But some other, Denzel Washington or something like that, is also hired to, as an FBI agent to look for the real reason is, as I mentioned before, that these guys were trained to fight against the Russians in Afghanistan and later dropped down by the Americans, so they changed the target and became terrorists in the USA. And in this movie, there are a lot of bomb attacks on buildings that were later reproduced by these famous airplane attacks, which you could also exercise on a Microsoft flight simulator at the period of time, which the terrorists, as we know, did before. And interestingly, immediately after September 11, Sir Norman Foster and Arupan Partners, so one of the biggest companies in the world, with one of the biggest engineering companies of the world, immediately presented their bomb attack or aeroplane attack safe skyscraper system with two structures with elastic static system that are interconnected with several ways of crossing from one side to the other with a lot of little sketches how their things can be improved. And I'm not kidding, this is now the standard of all skyscraper designs in the world, because it was then successfully implemented into building regulations and laws, which the architecture office and the steel industry, and then of course, fought hard for it. So skyscrapers, of course, cost much more now than before, but now you can take a full jumbo jet full with gasoline and kerosene and crash inside there, and it would still keep staying. Oops, sorry. And interestingly, in the movie The Siege, they also showed these cars with bombs attacking buildings, and later there was a real attack. Later, interestingly, American plazas became these weird deconstructivist skateboard areas. So for preventing this situation that a car can drive directly into the building, they made this interesting leg. So here this separation, so a car, in case you need these things disappearing to the floor, so you can drive up here and, you know, the taxi can come. But there's no chance to get up to the entrance and to drive with the bomb into the entrance. And I thought it was quite interesting that this beautiful fancy architecture was also done by very famous architects and looked really great, but then it was appropriated by youngsters who wanted to use this for skateboarding. But since this was the Federal Plaza building number one from the federal, you know, office of local administration, they didn't want to have skateboarders in front of their office. So they implemented something, anti-skateboard elements, which looks a bit like a multi-public space intervention, you know. And as you can see over here, these benches later were also altered to make benches where nobody can fall asleep, by some, you know, redesign. And you see here, this is a really, really great skateboard device. And interestingly, it was, of course, some of the young guys in the office of these famous architects who did the design originally, who really thought about skateboarding while designing, but later then was overruled by the local level. The 80s were also a period when the Irish Republican Army had launched several attacks in the city of London, which had a great effect on the engineering. It was a great effect that from that time on, British engineering offices and British facade companies were the leading companies in the world, and they again implemented their regulations into European-wide laws. And that's also something that happened, what Martin Bolle brought up at a period of time, that there emerged something like parallel architecture. If you have a, let's say, Bank of America building, on a dangerous place in the city of London, which can be easily attacked, you should not put in the computer, you should have not the computers in this building only, but also at a second and a third place. And this is also standard now that even the Austrian Railway Company has one central building where all the computers are that every person knows and should know. But they have three more data centers, which nobody should know, in totally insignificant buildings that in case that the terrorists or the Russian hackers would hack the first center, the other centers are still running. And this is a big business also with an enormous amount of money circulating, but nobody should know about it, so you would not read about it because it's secret. But secret, but very normal. And we come back to quite large scale measures. The city of Vienna in an old photograph. And as you all know, the city of Vienna had this Renaissance wall for protecting itself from the Turks or Ottomans for quite a long time. This was a major enemy, but then it turned out that they won't come anymore. So they had some minor Hungarian separatists the Viennese were fearing, so it was ridiculous to have this wall. So very, very late, the wall was teared down, and around this city wall, there was this 300-meter open area, which is a typical defensive system for all bigger cities of the period of time. So the distance is exactly matching with the distance of the artillery. So if somebody wants to attack Vienna, they have to move to here, and if they move to here, they can be easily shot from that side. On the other hand side, those who move here have the same artillery, so they can easily shoot at the wall or beneath the wall. So after a while, when artillery gets better and better, the wall makes no sense anymore. But the Viennese emperor was so backwarded that he kept the wall for quite a long time. And when he finally decided to, you know, allow a city development in this area, he was still so scared that he asked the military officers to be part of the planning committee. So what was actually built in Ringstrasse, what you all know, I suppose, this prestigious boulevard, had been three very large military barracks with armed forces that could easily overrun all potential revolutionaries of the period of time. Because when they started to plan Ringstrasse, the revolution started in Vienna in 48, and the emperor in our Austrian urban myth was looking out of the palace and asking his secretary, what are they doing there? And the secretary said, they're doing a revolution. And said, what is a revolution? And then the secretary explained what a revolution is and said, are they allowed to do that? And the other said, no, and he asked, what to do against it? He said, first we have to flee to the, you know, summer castle, and then we have to look for some armed troops to help us. And interestingly, it took until October that the emperor's administration found some four armed troops to come to Vienna to beat down the rebellious students. And very unhappy for our national self-explanation, it had been Croats that came up from, you know, southern border of the empire to beat the students, which of course had a nice life with a lot of alcohol and student discussions, and they were not really prepared for fighting against professional soldiers. And another interesting aspect is that in the city of London, the IRA attacks on the city had the effect that the city made a sort of zone of safety and security by making one-way streets. So they decided that there's no more normal traffic, but it's only seven places where you can enter the city, where you get checked by video camera, both the face and the number plate, and then you drive inside, and when you drive outside, you again checked so they know brutto netto who is missing. So if a bomb would explode and somebody's missing, then he must be the, you know, the evil guy. The interesting thing was when they implemented this system, some bomb exploded here, so several years later they expanded this system. And 7 years before, quite recently, they figured out that this is the perfect device for making a city tax for people driving in with a car. So they used an anti-terror device for getting better fresh air in the city and for taxing people driving with a car. So there's again some sort of a multiple benefit from a military decision in the city of London. And this is a very famous image from something you might not remember. In 2001, there had been a very famous G8 meeting in the Italian city of Genova, a very prestigious project for a guy called Berlusconi at that period of time, where he brought only G8, that means only the eight most important politicians, to the harbor of Genova. They rented a cruise ship boat for meetings, and they faced off the harbor area and made a sort of rezoning of the city for this 1 week. Let's say the conference was only 3 days, but it was 2 weeks preparing up the security system. And they had a green zone where everybody was allowed to move, a yellow zone where not everybody was allowed to move. So, because people were like demonstrators and activists were not allowed to go into the yellow zone. And then there was, of course, a red zone, and this is the border from yellow to red. As you can see, there's nobody in yellow because almost everybody was considered to be conspicuous from the side of the police. And this is a really great, let's say, artist intervention in public space with no purpose, but of course with a military purpose. And as you all know, that in this case, it got a bit out of control, that one of the demonstrators was shot by the police. But on the other hand side, there have been many demonstrators, even friends of mine there, that have been imprisoned. But for good reason, because they were really exercising warfare, how to attack, very idea to attack the 8 most famous politicians on the ferry boat at that time. So crime obviously sells in preventive measures in building industry. There are hundreds and thousands of companies advising administration, developers, etc., how to make places safer. But there are also a lot of scientific projects how to make places safer. Because of course, in the situation when most of the funding goes into military industry complex, some want to expand this field into the civic field. And it's interesting, in 2005, there was a very big European Union project where almost all the people in urban planning got seduced by the project how to get into the field of defensible places. And there's a long tradition in the US based on Oscar Newman's ideas of how to make places safer, which is not the time now to talk about, but it's quite well established. And I was also once upon a time invited to Munich because the police of Munich was publishing a handbook how to make places safer and architecture safer, and they felt so ashamed about that because they got the offer by the police. The police made the book and they wanted to publish it with the Association of Architects. The Association of Architects said, we don't want to do this issue without a discussion. And so they invited, interestingly, the chief police detective from Hamburg, who was a super right-wing populist politician as well, and me as the leftist populist theoretician, and it was a great show. So we had our time and we all spoke the opposite from each other. Half of the people had been policemen on education, other half of the people had been architects on education, and at the end he shook my hand, so good show, and he congratulated me to this book. Then I said, I don't believe that you have read it, and said, no, of course I didn't read it, but my secretary read it. He was very much appreciated. So I don't know if he lied, you know, because he's just a charming guy. So populist in good sense and in bad sense. But anyway, now we come to another aspect, the so-called cultural productivity of crime. And Marx himself brought up some examples in his little text. One was Richard the Third by Shakespeare, the other one was The Robbers by Schiller. So he really brought up classic theater pieces to give evidence that murder and politics and pre-revolutionary philosophies combined in theater performances of theater pieces as a sort of moral discourse. And interestingly, very long until the 1910, the urban discourse were very much based on medical associations. So the city was considered to be a physical body with organs, with arteria, which are the streets, with some sort of diseases the physical body of the city might have, and by operations we could eliminate sick parts of the city and implement fresh new ones to heal the city. So urban design for quite a long time was a sort of semi-medical operation. And as you all know, Baron Haussmann's transformation of Paris was very much based on these medical ideas that we just put in new boulevards for better circulation of air and people, and we just design the unwanted people out of the body by tearing down the neighborhood and building up new quarters. The same was basically discussed about Vienna, but in Vienna they didn't tear down anything because the Ringstrasse was totally empty area before. And interestingly, at the end of 19th century, beginning of 20th century, as something new came up in urban discourse, which is very logical, of course, not logical. In Vienna, there was some guy called Sigmund Freud, who, as you all know, invented psychoanalysis and who introduced a sort of analogy of the different layers of mind, the layers of archaeology of the city, and also later some others brought up the same about the detection of how an artwork works. So they studied an interrelation between urban archaeology, psychoanalysis, and the perception of the city. And it's interesting that the godfather of urban sociology and anthropology, Robert Ezra Park, in Chicago, was highly inspired by Sigmund Freud's lecture in New York, which he had seen in 1910, and then somehow added Freud's weird ideas into his own idea of how urban space is investigated. And Robert Ezra Park, and that is very important, was starting as a journalist for daily newspapers, and as a journalist for daily newspapers, he wanted to learn about the city. So what was he doing? He was going to that places where the policemen were hanging around for lunch and for drinks, and then he was chasing the policemen around the city because he thought that the policemen would know where something interesting is going on. So after a while, of course, he knew the best places, so then he started to hang around with the gangsters of the city to figure out, you know, and in his romantic approach, he was thinking that the gangsters would know the authentic places of the city. And since then, and it's interesting that the first books that the Chicago School made had been all about the social underclasses of the city. So about the homeless, the hobo, the mafia, and you can imagine that if you have some sort of upper class kids studying, you know, urban anthropology, who then go to the slums and ask the homeless about their experience, about what the city really is, or they go to they visit Al Capone and ask him, you know, how he sees the city. And that is quite interesting because this is the sort of birthplace of urban anthropology combined with romanticism and psychoanalysis. And this is something that cannot get rid. Today, psychoanalytical approach to the city is a no-go in science. So, you know, if I would make this lecture at the Academy of Fine Arts with my friend, the real architecture tradition, she would kick me out, you know, denounce me for total, you know, this sexist, old-fashioned stuff. If I would repack it in Lacan theory so that nobody would understand anything, it would be okay, you know, but Freud has this very simple explanation, so that's why he was so successful at that period of time. And what is interesting is that Robert Ezra Park also argued that all the devices we know how to do research came from police work. So the so-called interview was not an interview of the journalist first, but it was, you know, taking the criminal and interviewing him about the crime as a technique. Photography was widely produced for policing and military devices, which is very beautifully described by an essay of Alan Sekulow, one of the most important American photographers who recently died. And many of these progresses are embedded in crime detection or prevention. And I brought some of examples from these, let's say, wider cultural industries. For example, this is an ad from Osram Lamp Production from the 20s, where they show that the Bob as a policeman who is, you know, chasing the criminal. The criminal looks like a football goalie of my grandfather's period of time. So of course, it's only a little step to some sort of racist misrepresentation, but it's a great advertisement because he says it would be much safer in our streets when, yeah, everything would be lit by Osram. But it's a poetic argumentation. This is a scientific work of a student of mine in Graz. She desperately wanted to make a crime rate mapping of the city of Graz. In the city of Graz, almost nothing happens. It was a very boring investigation. but she went to all the police departments of the city and figured out which crimes are they know they have noted, you know. And then she was making this Excel diagram. So the higher the peak, the more crimes happen. And the funny thing is, she had to widen up the crimes. And the most, let's say, the most popular crime in Graz is the theft of bicycles. And interestingly, the theft of bicycles happens in front of the universities and in front of the railway station. So these are the, you know, the most dangerous places. If you just watch this diagram. And then they also had some interesting places in the city where they had a lot of clearly gendered attacks for men or women. And she was then thinking, ah, that's great, that's in the red light district, which is true. But then she went, then I told her she should ask the policeman what it really is, and they figured out it is, there is a lot of assault of men against women in this district, but not because of prostitution, but because of what we call Frauenhaus, you know, these protective areas for women which got divorced or are in the process of divorcing, are safe from their husbands. These are secret places, but of course it is difficult to keep them entirely secret, so very often husbands find out where the women are, and so they try to attack these buildings. And in their regression, they attack every woman as representative of their own one who left them, so they have an enormous crime rate in exactly one place in the city, but of course then the whole district gets diabolized by this statistic data. But anyway, in Austria, nobody really takes these diagrams seriously up to now. But we know there are other parts in the world, like in the United States, where this would be then the, you know, the decision to tear down the one block in the center because it's so dangerous. Another interesting aspect I brought up already is photography. Jakob Ries is one of the most famous photographers of the turn of the century, who made photographs of the slums of New York's East Side, originally commissioned by the police. So he was a photographer, photographing all the slums for the police to figure out, you know, what is the condition of the city and where are the dangerous places. And while doing the photographs, he got into sort of Stockholm syndrome and changed sides. So he canceled his job at the police and became the first social activist using these photographs as anthropological evidence of, let's say, economic and social misdevelopment in the capital city of New York. And another interesting aspect is, normally I should play this song. It's Grandmaster Flash, Heroes of My Earlier Days. Nicely wrapped, don't push me because I'm close to the edge. I try not to lose my hat. It's a jungle, sometimes it makes me wonder how I keep from going under. And here, let's say middle class kids behave as being gangster rappers and assimilate themselves with dress code as musicians to the urban underclasses and glorify the jungle of the city as the underground where they fight to survive. Actually, they sold a lot of records with these lyrics, and I don't know that I think they won't be endangered at all from economic problems. But anyway, it is very interesting that the self-glorification of the art world as being in the underground has a very strong appeal also to myself, of course. And when I made the book and I did some research, I got into a very painful, period of experience, because I met some professor of literature who told me I should read this global book. And then I wrote this book and then I was totally confused, because there's some guy called Balzac who wrote already 1830 exactly the same stuff about Paris, in other words, where the artist, the poet, is living in the underground of the big city, celebrating himself as the only one who knows how the city works, the authentic city works. And there's a long tradition since the 1830s, 40s, 50s of the native Indian, you know, the Mohicans of Paris, that stroll around the canal system of Paris as the heroes of that time. And later on, when I had a short period of my life and I wanted to become a punk, you know, art academy punk musician. And so we thought that punk is some typical 80s thing, so it's contemporary. But then we figured out that punk is an invention of 1845, by a poet living in Paris. This is really depressing. So it's a sort of adolescent adventure that failed. And in each of the cities at this period of time, there had been specific journalists and researchers that were looking for the places where the poor people live. These are photographs from the city of Vienna by a retired lawyer and a photographer who went down the canal system of the city of Vienna to make photographs where the poor people live. And they offered that as a series of lectures at educational institutions, and they were so extremely successful that they had to repeat them several times, exactly 300 times. And then they made a booklet with photographs, which became a standard must-have for all the bourgeois households. You have a booklet in your warm apartment to see the photographs of how the poor people of the city of Vienna lived at that period of time. And at the end of their presentation, to make it hot, they also made, they showed, because it was called the places of poverty and crime, because only poverty would not sell. So they showed a sort of attack in the suburbs of Vienna. You know, the evil guys in the suburbs. An interesting thing, at that period of time, you have to imagine that the exposure time of a camera was extremely long. So you cannot make just snapshots of an attack. So you have to tell the people, please, you know, wait a while with a knife. So everything is staged, of course, and everybody knows that it's staged, but nevertheless, it people love to believe it and follow their lectures and or just the book. When I've been to LA, where the project started, I found this in a lifestyle magazine, I found a real estate article where the boys are, so where are the gangsters in New York, in LA. And so you had a sort of map of the city of LA with the territories of the gangs, with a degree of danger. So this is extremely dangerous, so don't invest your money here. The other one is less dangerous, but you would be stupid to purchase a house there as well, etc., etc. And this wouldn't work in Austria at all because people don't care. But in the United States, as you all know, this is really driving real estate economy. And when something is really bad, it's acknowledged, like in St. Louis in 72, which marked the beginning of postmodern architecture in the Book of Kings. And what is interesting is that most of us know all these cities and the discourses of the city, not from real experience, but from cinema and TV, and probably in the future we know the city from social media only, but not from real city, because we walk the same paths every day and the rest of the city is coming in by media devices. One of the most famous movies of all urban history is, of course, Fritz Lang's Metropolis. And what the early time directors did for explaining the city was that they introduced a vertical social hierarchy in the city, which made it more dramatic for the film. So the rich people are living up there in the penthouse, of course, and the middle class is here, and the poor people are living in the canal system, as introduced by French poets in 19th century already. And we all know that the tension of the city in these movies, going up from the lowest floor to the highest floor and back again. And interestingly, this was then highly elaborated by Ridley Scott's Blade Runner, put into the future. Ridley Scott's Blade Runner was like Metropolis, Blade Runner, and Matrix had been, let's say, movies of almost pornographic theoretical appeal to my generation of architects and urban planners, because it's fiction, it's pure fiction, but it's explaining the city in a way that makes it really attractive. In Ridley Scott's Blade Runner, there's even an outside of the world, and you can distinguish between roboters and normal characters, and in Matrix, there are even more levels. It goes down into the center of the earth, into the basement, into the normal form, and even in one scene in the Matrix 1, the hero is doing a telephone call with God, which is absolutely absurd, but it's an interesting organization which makes it more readable than if it's a horizontal segregation. And in many of the movies, there is also a sort of fight about the control of the city between policemen and gangsters. And it's interesting that my Viennese friend, Max Edelbacher from the Vienna police, also told me that this was so exciting for him in the job as policeman, that he was the the highest ranking criminal policeman. So we always went to the highest ranking criminals. You know, so this was patriarchal system. So I'm couple, you're couple, shake hands, respect. So we have a problem. And he said that in many cases he solved the problem just by talking to the couples of the other side. And they were honored that the policeman knocks at the door and just wants to have a coffee tea or a schnapps and discuss problems in our city, you know, sharing the control of the city between police and criminals as a sort of cohabitation, which nowadays would not work anymore officially because this is a problem of, you know, corruption or moral disorientation. And interestingly, this is, for example, a great cop film, Dirty Harry, but what is interesting in this movie, one scene that there's a sniper who goes up to a skyscraper to shoot down people by fun. And interestingly, you see, he's selecting the people, but then interestingly, a helicopter comes because police is even above them. And the helicopter, again, they also have their glasses, you know, to scan the city, and then they force him to escape. And this interesting sort of ambiguous gaze of the city has a very strong tradition in film, and also in one of the best films about urban theory that I know. The film is horrible. It's a horror movie, but a horrible movie. Candyman by Bernard Rose from 1992. It's a really old movie, but it's interesting. Like the movie I've shown the movie in the beginning, but the fortress at the beginning makes this an introduction into Michel Foucault's control ideas, a Pentheim's control idea for idiots, you know, so theory for beginners. This is also something, it's Chicago School Urban Research for Beginners. And what happens in this movie is that they introduce Michel Desoteaux's perception of the city in all degrees, and they introduce the Chicago School by all degrees. So this is the establishing shot at the beginning of the movie. The camera goes in a helicopter absolutely in parallel with one of the biggest highways that are crossing through Chicago. The music is by Phil Glass, so the, you know, the intellectual electronic musician who makes repetitive music, which is intellectual and scary at the same time. And interestingly, so we follow the helicopter and what Michel Desoteaux would have called the divine voyeur that is looking down from a very large distance on the city as a concept that you can plan, direct, and control. And the camera stays constantly in the same position until there is a big crossing. And interestingly, the titles are driving in exactly on the streets. So it's a really beautiful intro. It's an art piece by itself. And then strangely, the streets separate. And then there's a cut, and we are half distance above the inside yard of the Faculty of Urban Planning of the University of Illinois Chicago, where it all began in the 20s. And then we have a second cut, and then we're in the lecture hall. And then we see some typical casual American professor in urban studies, and if somebody would have time in a mainstream Hollywood, mainstream horror movie, you could see at the back on the blackboard his five rules of urban design, of urban research. And this guy, of course, has a love relationship to one of the students that is obviously a must-have in the United States. Although I was teaching once for an American university, and it was very fun for me because I had an extra lesson from the dean in sexual harassment that I had no idea what's wrong, you know, and in cheating. Because I don't know what's wrong with cheating, because if students cheat very well, they are well organized. And I don't know what is sexual harassment if everybody is more than 19 years old. And I never had the idea that you can give, you know, remarks for sex or the other way around. You have sex and then you're, then people pass through the whole academy without doing anything anymore, because otherwise you go to court and the Princeton, the reputation of Princeton University is over for all the time anyway. But he is, of course, having a love affair with one of his doctoral students, which wants to make research about Gabrini Green housing estate in Chicago. Gabrini Green housing estate is one of the post-Second World War mass housing complexes that were highly discussed all the time, very much diabolized, a very dangerous place. And she's doing interviews in the university with black girls that are living in Gabrini-Gri, but cleaning the university. So you see, she doesn't leave the university for doing interviews because the people come in anyway for service jobs. And then she is invited by him to the old professor, cafeteria table, and then the old professor tells her what, in real words, Robert Ezra Park told all the students: forget about theory, forget about books, forget about your university, you know, take off your ass and go to the place where the great happens. And that is what she then does. And then the horror movie got on rock and rolling. And the camera stays in half position when she's driving with her little Japanese car to this housing estate. And as you can see, it was definitely not in a very good shape. Then the camera, once they arrive in the housing estate, the camera goes on eye level. And it's interesting, in the movie, whenever it's about more abstract aspects, then the camera goes in very large distance. When it's about half myth, half abstract, it goes in half distance. And if it's about the real life, it goes in eye distance. And she takes her friend with her into the housing estate. Of course, they got bullied by some drug dealers, and finally they figure out that this housing estate is empty, and there is a myth she's doing research about. The myth says that there is a black guy who was accused of murder, and he always had refused that he'd done it, but then he was imprisoned and killed by some accident, and still lives as a ghost in this area. And this is, as far as I remember, Denzel Washington, big black guy, big jacket, a hook on one hand, and his mouth is always full of bees. And he lives in his honeycomb, a sort of a semblance of several empty apartments. He made holes from one to the other to escape from one to the other, who has a lot of graffitis, a lot of trash. And people say, as a rumor in this apartment, that whenever somebody dies or children are dying, Candyman has been there giving them candies, and in the candy they have some razor blade inside that the children would die, from bleeding inside. And some people say it's not true, other people say yes, it's true, and so she goes there and wants to know about it. And she figures out from plans, she studied about architecture, that you can cross from one apartment to the other by opening this mirror above the bathtub. So this is, you know, mirrored apartments, and the mirror is the entrance to the next apartment. And so here you see her climbing into the next apartment. And then she's in this very dark honeycomb. And when she enters, it's a really great place. You see this big graffiti of a black face, and she's coming into it through the mouth of this person, and finds a sort of altar situation where her name is sprayed onto the wall, that you are the only one I love, written obviously by this beautiful black ghost, that then somehow very strangely takes over power by her. In our Freudian association, you would think that the ghost had sex with her and took part of her body for having the chance to leave the housing block. And what does he do? He follows her to the Faculty of Architecture and Urban Research to kill all the professors that had done bad research about his estate. And of course, this is totally absurd, but it's nice. And in the end, she figures out that she has to kill herself, you know, sacrifice herself for saving the world from this ghost. And so when there's some, I don't know, specific festival with a fire, she throws herself into the fire to burn herself, and then her own ghost is climbing up to heaven and returning for Candyman 2, 3, 4, 5 to come up later. But of course, this would have been a sort of post-feminist horror movie with a female ghost, which there is no role model for, so they altered the system and it was the same evil guy forever and ever. But what is to me extremely interesting on this movie is that Michel Desateau's idea that there is this this distant view from very far away, and then there is this from romanticized urban life, the urban myth, you're embedded into the everyday tricksters who try to cope with life on ground, that there is a big danger being really embedded. Because if you're really embedded and then you're really open for the urban myth swallow you, like in this image. So the problem is either you didn't get it at all in the long distance, in the large distance, then you will be probably a very good architect who can do very good design because he doesn't care about it all, at all about what's going on, so aesthetically. And the other way is you become a very good anthropologist, and then you cannot plan anything anymore because you're totally in the system and you have so many, you know, cross relations and new friendships that you just have locked off for the rest of your life. And of course, as we all know, also architects like me are extremely desirable following the urban myth and try to get down, but try to put themselves out in a critical distance again. And this is a difficult task, and I think that this is a great thing that this very bad horror movie can tell us. Thank you.